All right, here we go. Day two, session two. Putting it back together. Looking rather nicer than I intended. Quite smart, actually. So let's get it back together. I don't like seeing it standing here looking forlorn. I gave just some quick spray to the bottom of the mudguard. If you saw part one, you'll know that this is about to be covered over. So all I want on there is protection. Now, one accessory you haven't seen is this great big Gazelle factory original mud flap, which goes like that. A humongous thing it is. And it came from this beauty, and I've always thought it spoiled this beautiful bike, having that great big black mud flap on there. So I've removed it. In doing so, that entailed using the Gazelle badge that was on the back mudguard of this grey bike to finish that. So that's fine now. And that's also going to donate two more things. Because it's not an everyday bike, it's a high days and holidays bike, there's no need for it to have the upgraded dynamo that I fitted. So I shall put the Gazelle factory dynamo back on there and use this one, which is a posh Nordlik 2000 low rolling resistance with a rubber wheel, and I'm going to pop that on here because this bike will actually be used in the dark. And also in the rear light on the back mudguard on this gold bike there is an LED, so I shall swap that back to bulb and put the LED in here. That'll be a very useful upgrade. I'm keeping in mind what this bike actually is and what its role is going to be. So I think it's best if I drop the mudguard stays off at the spindle, and it gives me a bit of extra wiggle room to get these two screws out and then put them back in. This simply goes on with this clamp like that. This stainless steel bracket just clamps it in place there. Now another little Gazelle piece is the, I'll show you, Gazelle branded headlamp. I've put an LED in this one. It was halogen originally. It's of that era. That is one aspect of bicycles that's really, really improved the development of the LED. It's fantastic. I have no qualms about putting LEDs in older lamps. If it's a vintage bike and I want it to have its charm and I'm not riding it seriously at night, then fine, keep that lovely warm glow, and particularly with a clear lens, you know, when you see the bulb. But for actually riding the bikes at night, LEDs all the way for me. Now you'll be able to see the wire coming out of the steerer tube here. It's just been wrapped around here ready to plug in. I'll do that when I've got the lamp on. In fact, I'll do it last, because I'll obviously be wiring in the rear lamp as well, fitting the LED in it. There will be faff and fiddle. There always is setting up dynamo lights. I like dynamo light sets, but they are a faff to set up, and I don't like messy wiring. That's why I like these bikes with concealed wiring. That's about it. And again, a bit more of its dignity restored now. I do have such a thing for Gazelles. And I also like my accessories. In fact, it's my favourite part. Always has been, since being a kid. It's been my favourite part of doing bikes, has been the accessories. And 2 minutes looking at my collection will tell you that. I do love an accessory. And now I think it's time to start looking at the back. Get that mudguard on, get the carrier on, the wheel in, chain case on, and that'll be it. Okay, I think the first thing we need to get on is this mudguard. So, lining up the front, threading through the back, and I think the crucial one to get in first is going to be this top one. So, a little M5. Put my tray down on your side there. And I want a nice short little M5 screw. So to make life easier, I'm just putting a zip tie through, and that will hold the mudguard up, stop any catastrophes while I'm sorting out for screws. Not tight, just enough to hold it up there, and then obviously I'll drop that off as soon as I get the screws in. But it just helps me to move it around to the exact place, make sure all my holes are lined up, and get a start on the screws without the thing falling down all over the place. Right, a nice stubby screw that doesn't protrude down into the tire area, and also doesn't need me to put a screwdriver on the top where I can't get it in. This is actually a little hex socket on there, so I can just pop an Allen key in and that's fine. Same down on the front now, the bottom. Now the next little conundrum is getting the wires through the hole from the back into here. That was so fiddly, I'm glad I didn't record it all. Right, we have one with a white stripe, that will be the live, I'm sure. Stick that in the bulb holder, then when the bulb's screwed in, that will hold that. And we have an earth terminal here without a screw in it. Fortunately, I haven't thrown out the old mudguard, so I can use the screw. And I haven't forgotten I'm putting an LED in here, so I shall go and fetch that from the other bike. Nice little replacement LED from Nice Light. There's the little earth screw that you saw me access in part one. There's also a holder here for a spare bulb, which is rather nice touch. They all have them. And there we are, the lens on, which I haven't even cleaned. But of course, that's not all we rely on for a beta bike in the winter. There's also the matter of the carrier, and this will have a light on of its own. Now this fitting is better if it's got screwdriver access at this side, because you can come straight in. And I'm also putting Nylock nuts on to avoid anything rattling free. It turns out to get a level rack, it does need to use these extension brackets, which John fitted for the non-Gazelle carrier that he put on. So I shall do that now. Now, I mentioned not relying on the dynamo lights. A nice, inexpensive, but good quality German rear light to go onto the standard European fittings on the rack. There we are. Pull the tab out. Hey! Right, now quite an unpleasant task. As you will have noticed before, probably, this chain has been incredibly over-oiled to a remarkable degree. It's been over-oiled. So, I now have to handle it in order to put the back wheel in. And I can only find one glove. At least I can have one clean hand. The usual bother getting it past the end of the slots, even with a deflated tyre. It's a right nuisance. I could even see a case for taking the mudguard stays off, to be honest. I can see why Gazelle chopped off the back centimetre of the bottom slot here as well, and they created some special offset chain tensioners. I'm wondering if I might modify this one. I'm sure I've got some. Let me see if I've got some Gazelle offset chain tensioners. If I have, I'm going to do a little modification. I've got one. See, this is the thing. So, with some lopped off the bottom of there, that just takes the place of a normal one. And it gives you a bit of extra room to get your wheel in. Pity I can't find another one. Let me have another look. Yep, I found another one. Right, everything gathered together that I need for what is quite a major operation. Putting a wheel in one of these, there we are. That's a start. Right. That faces to the rear to anchor the chain case, top and bottom. Inside of that is the chain itself. Get that on, then fix the chain guard, and now I can start looking at things like the chain tensioner, which was on the outside on this one. Sometimes they're on the inside, sometimes they're on the outside. This one was on the outside. Remember when I took it off? So, being on the outside, pop it on there, onto the axle, spindle rather, and now it fits nicely over the modified dropout. Apply some tension to the chain. You can tell this is a genuine Gazelle one. Nice little stainless steel fitting on the end there. Because what I'm doing here will be repeated on the other side. And this is what the chain tensioner actually does. It keeps the chain tensioned, and then the wheel nut just holds the wheel in. Two separate functions. Does require use of the correct size spanner though. Now, see the tension going on the chain there? Not too much, obviously, don't over tension it, but right, that's getting there. That is going to alter slightly when I tighten the nut up and just pull the chain stay in that last little bit. So that's a temporary adjustment. Now we have the anti-rotation washer, which has its tab facing forward, so it goes over there and still reaches into the slot. Then the familiar Sturmey Archer nut. I could, at this point, update it to one of the covers that come. No, let's just stay with what we've got, what we know. Keep it simple, stupid. Right. Time, I think, for the bottom half of the chain case. Which I didn't clean, but never mind. Feels pretty loose until it clips together. What a stupid and obvious thing to say. That's not how that goes on there. I've got this the wrong way around. It goes forwards. Oh, don't say that you're on a... You can't be on a flat, no. You can't be. You must turn around. Yes, you do. Alright, there you are. That bracket goes there. Unfamiliar territory now, these chain guards. I mean, I know them, but I wouldn't call them familiar. Right. Right, all I've done since you were last looking is tighten up the Sturmey Archer cable, adjusted it so it's just off tight in top gear. That's usually bang on. So the last job is to pop around the other side, put the brake anchor arm bolt on, and the rod which operates the brakes, put that on and adjust it. So first thing is the brake anchor, which, as I've said in previous videos, is not rhyming slang. I had also just temporarily hooked the rod over, drop it out of the way now on the stand, just so I can get my big hands and fat fingers in there. This is why I'm not suited to fine work. As I call it, fiddly work. Dynamo light wiring and such as that. There we are. 10. That needs to be tight, obviously, because the force of the braking goes through it. Right, the rod passes, should be straight, unlike that, passes inside, inboard of the kickstand, simply hooks onto there, and then pull the tension off it and tighten it up until it's just about stopping the wheel, until you can see there's friction on there. I'm going to back that off. A couple of half turns, which it's not wanting to do. There we go. That's better. Right. Try another half turn. That's just binding there, see? So just... That's it. That's the point where it's just about to bind. There is, because there are various pivots in this mechanism, there's always a little bit of slack. So you want the rear drum to be just catching, and then back off very, very slightly. So you may be, you know, a fraction of a millimetre away from biting there. That's how you want it, because this has to come on slightly before the front brake. As I pull the lever, you can see all the various pivots in operation. And there's the front being pulled there. Notice how it's set up so that there's more pull to the rear than there is to the front as well. The arms are different lengths. The pivots are in different places for the front and the back. If I show you here on the handlebars, that's the front, that's the back, so the back is actually being pulled further than the front. And that again is to apply the rear brake a bit more than the front brake. Very clever mechanism. I made a video a few years ago about it. You might be able to find it. Try searching for Gazelle braking system or something like that. Now, one of the many applications of Sod's Law when I'm doing these YouTubes is, as soon as I say And all I have to do now is, that's the point at which I remember the six other things. I was going to change the dynamo and put the Nordlicht 2000 on. This should work as it is. I also need, of course, to pop the light wires in as well. You don't have to watch me do all that. What we've essentially got now is a finished bike. So it's dark outside, so I can't take it for a test ride. It's usually nice to finish off these videos with me riding it around the block or something. I can't do it on this one tonight because it's dark and raining outside. Oh look, another job to do, pump up the rear tyre. So I'm going to tidy up and call it a night. And I know now that this bike is finished. I need to get wrapped up and get this video edited and in the can tonight, because from tomorrow we start a very busy period here in the Velocipedium. The project I've been really waiting to start for ages, really looking forward to because I love the bike, is this Boulevard Tourist, Rally Boulevard Tourist from I think 58. And tomorrow, I'm very pleased to say, I'm picking up rescuing some more projects. Two projects and two complete going running bikes. I won't tell you what they are, but two of them are perfect stable mates for this. They're even the same year and they're made in the same factory. And that three of them, when you see them next to each other, were very complimentary of each other. Two other bikes are both rallies as well, but a different kettle of fish. Still three speeds, and that's all I'm giving away. So make sure you're subscribed, make sure you hit that little bell, because you're not going to want to miss what's coming up over the next few weeks. Starting in the next couple of days, you'll see the first of the intro videos of the new bikes. I don't know what order I'm doing them in. Then the two bikes that are in running condition, they will both get a check over and get some tweaks. There's things I want to do to them, little changes and things. So I can do a nice little video on each of those, and then start taking him out. And then set two on the renovations of the three old ones. Three from 1958. Yeah, they're all the same year. So, thanks for watching this. And hopefully we'll see you a lot over the next few weeks. Bye-bye now. Well, what can I say? I don't know. Frankly, I'm disappointed in you guys. Call yourselves viewers. There I was, prattling on about being finished. And not one of you, not one person, stuck up their hand and said, "Hey, Rowan, weren't you going to fit a lock?" Not paying attention. That's what it is. My videos are obviously far too boring. But I'm an old man. I can't be expected to remember all this nonsense myself. Need your help, you know. Anyway, seriously, thanks for watching. Bye bye now.